We're going to have a conversation. Hi, this is Dr. Fab Mancini, and I'm so excited that you are here with us because I want to introduce you one of the top attorneys on personal injury in the United States, Brian Larson from the state of Utah. Brian, it's so great to have you with me today, and I'm so looking forward to having this conversation with you.
Well, thank you. Good to meet you, too.
You know, you've been around for over 35 years, taking care of tremendous amount of clients and also having a great relationship with doctors. In fact, you're known for doctors loving working with you. And I know you're going to be at the Personal Injury Summit that's going to be conducted March 15th through the 17th in the state of Utah, right there in Salt Lake City. I was a keynote speaker last year. I was so impressed with this event because it gives you everything that you need in order to run successfully whiplash cases, but also any personal injury cases that you may be dealing with right now. So one of the things that I love about Dr. Shedling and bringing you on board is the fact that as an attorney, you have tremendous amount of value. So tell me a little bit about what started you in this journey in wanting to do personal injury cases, and what do you find as the most fulfilling in your day-to-day job by helping so many cases get resolved?
Well, I actually started out my career working on the defense side of the table. I was a defense attorney for a couple of years, and the reality of it is that I then had an experience personally with chiropractic care. I had strained my neck and had a sort of a torticollis kind of experience with my neck, and I went to a chiropractor, and with a couple of adjustments, I realized, hey, this stuff works, and I started exploring it and looking into it a lot more. And about the same time, I also had an experience in handling, even though I was primarily on the defense side, I did do some plaintiff's work, and I had a case that was pretty successful. And the clients from that case thanked me for it. And I thought, wow, I never get that from the adjusters, from the insurance company. I mean, they might say, hey, you know, good job, we'll send you another case. But I never had previously a client come up to me and say, Mr. Larson, thank you so much. You've changed my life. You've really helped me. You've made a difference. You helped us in a very difficult time here. And with the money that you got from the settlement, we can take and be able to heal and pay for more care and get on with our lives. And I thought that was very rewarding. And so it was soon thereafter I made the transition to full-time. I changed firms, and I went with a plaintiff's operation. And then within a couple of years after that, I launched my own operation.
You know, Brian, one of the things that I love about you is the fact that not only your clients love you, but the doctors love you. So let me ask you this question. You know, as a chiropractor, we know that we've been very effective in helping a lot of personal injury cases resolve whiplash injuries. And we have tremendous amount of science that supports that. But more importantly, we have a great track record in helping people. Now, as you know, personal injury has changed over time. And you have some chiropractors and some states that still do a lot of personal injury. I still believe whether you are in a state that deals with personal injury or not, you need to deal with these type of cases because we're very effective. So tell me a little bit about what changes are you seeing in the industry when it comes to personal injury and in your experience being such a prominent personal injury attorney.
There's no question that the entire personal injury landscape has changed dramatically in the past 35 years. We are seeing a much greater demand on chiropractors to be able to objectify their diagnosis and objectify the progress that they're making with the patient in order to justify the care that they're providing. The insurance industry is now attacking every aspect of a case, including not only who caused the accident, but the causation of the injuries themselves. They're pointing to any cause they can. We even have instances where, if the chiropractic physician doesn't get that early MRI, and if it subsequently appears that there's a herniation, the insurance industry will actually accuse the chiropractic physician of causing that herniation. which we know statistically is very, very difficult to do and doesn't happen. But the chiropractor that doesn't prepare by getting that baseline MRI early, and I'm talking about within the first 8 weeks at least, or maybe even before the first adjustment, he leaves himself open to the accusation that herniation was something that he caused through his care. And we also have found, it's interesting too, that chiropractic has changed a great deal. You mentioned, Fab, that there's a great deal of scientific support for this. I won't say that chiropractic was looked upon as voodoo 35 years ago, but it was mostly a profession that was based upon testimonial evidence, people that had tried it, that had found that it worked. But now we've got studies. The explosion of research in the chiropractic area has been absolutely wonderful and refreshing because now when the defense attorney says, oh, well, that's only the chiropractor saying that, we could say, no, it's not. It's actually studies found in Spine magazine or in, you know, some of the other notable medical journals that now are recognizing chiropractic. And as you know, it used to also be that the medical community used to be almost at war with the chiropractic community. That war is over with, and now more and more doctors are joining hands with chiropractors and recognizing that there is a valid place at the healthcare table for the chiropractor. And so that battle continues. It continues mostly because the insurance industry doesn't want to believe it. But it also continues in the minds of the public who's still uninformed. But chiropractic is much more accepted now, and it's very refreshing to see than it was, you know, years ago. There's still a lot of room to go. But one of the best ways that we take those steps with chiropractors is to have their documentation and their case files up to snuff, where things are made objective, where proper diagnostic codes are used in their diagnosis of the case, where proper progress is measured, that the chiropractor no longer simply says, well, there's a decreased range of motion or an improvement of the range of motion. They actually list how many degrees or how much objectively the change in range of motion has been. And that way we can actually measure it. That's the biggest thing that chiropractors probably need to learn. A lot of times it's laziness. A lot of times chiropractors get used to the simple cash pay health maintenance patient comes in. And when they get into the forensic area, though, and that patient has a personal injury case, a lot greater care needs to be taken with regard to documentation of what's going on. But I guess the biggest thing, Fab, that makes us different from other attorneys in this area is the fact that we really understand and believe in chiropractic. Probably, and I'm a past president of the Utah Association for Justice, sometimes known as Utah Trial Lawyers Association. We changed our name a few years ago. And unfortunately, I have to admit there are far too many of those attorneys who still won't refer to a chiropractor when the case is appropriate for chiropractic care. They don't understand it. They don't necessarily believe in it. And those attorneys are the same ones that try to get chiropractors to cut their bills when it's time for disbursement of the settlement funds. So, and we generally don't do that unless it's absolutely necessary. We really understand chiropractors. We believe in chiropractic, and we try to build the chiropractic profession. One of those ways that we build the chiropractic profession is by participating in and even sponsoring our own seminars, like the one coming up in March here in Utah on March 15th through 17th. And by the way, the University Park Marriott Hotel is an exceptional hotel in Utah. It's a wonderful place, tremendous views, and anybody that attends is going to have a really positive experience.
Well, you know, one of the things that I love about the Whiplash Group, and in particular the Personal Injury Summit, is the fact that it's become one of the most premier personal injury events in the country. But I love it because it not only brings you the science, it doesn't only bring you the right protocols, it teaches you from A through C what are some of the things you need to be aware of and what are some of the things that you need to do to be on the top of your game, to make sure that we're taking care of these patients the best way possible, but also make sure that we're documenting along the way. And like you mentioned, using the proper codes, but make sure that we continue to show the improvement of that patient through our documentation and the value that chiropractic has. I love the fact that in this event, you also have attorneys like you in the audience. individuals that are truly committed, wanting to learn about what is the new science in chiropractic, who are the biggest scientists, and you know, the beautiful thing about this program is that it brings the top people in our profession, but even outside of our profession, that allows the attendees to really walk out of there with all the tools that they need to be effective. Effective as a personal injury, in a personal injury case or any type of whiplash case. So in your career, tell me a little bit about what are some of the things that you feel that as a chiropractor, what do you look for in a chiropractor when you want to work with them? What is it, some of the basic things that you or your firm looks for, and you can say that's the kind of chiropractor we want to work with?
That's really easy to talk about that. I noticed that you've got a great deal of background with Parker Chiropractic, and of course Parker produces an exceptional graduate. But they're of course not the only ones that do that. But Parker does a great job. But when we look for a chiropractor to work with, we look for somebody who is not only an excellent clinician, but somebody who's going to be able to document the work that they do and document it well. And somebody who's not going to be afraid to work with other professionals. Typically, the multi-professional approach is the strongest. When you've got two or three witnesses testifying of the same thing, it tends to make the case stronger. And that's a principle that applies to many areas of life, but it really applies in the forensic area especially. And it's nice to have a chiropractor that is not afraid to send the person out for early radiology and is not afraid to say, wait a second, here's a problem that ought to at least be checked out by another professional. Even if it's to a surgeon, even if surgery is not necessary, it's better that be ruled out as a valid option, so that chiropractic care can be therefore ruled in as the next best thing if surgery is not appropriate in a particular case. On the other hand, if the case is surgical, it looks really bad for the chiropractor to continue trying to adjust an area that in fact is, if it's in the spine, if it's unstable, if it's in the shoulder and you got a torn rotator cuff, I'm sorry, most adjustments are not going to fix a torn rotator cuff that requires surgery. But having said that, we typically try to urge our patients to at least try chiropractic first in every instance. Unless it's an obvious surgical matter, we like to have the chiropractor play quarterback of the care, and we like the chiropractor then to direct the other care providers, or at least direct the patient out to the other care providers that may be appropriate from there. But it begins with chiropractic. And because of that, the chiropractor has to be not just a technician, but he must be a physician. He must be a physician that treats the entire person. Chiropractors tend to specialize in the spine, but there may be extremities that need to be looked at as well. There may be psychosocial components, PTSD, other kinds of things, TMJ issues that the chiropractor also needs to be aware of. Minor traumatic brain injury cases also, oftentimes, post-concussive syndrome things oftentimes are under-documented, we find with chiropractors. And so we looked at a physician who's going to be a physician, who's going to look at the entire patient, examine every aspect of the injuries, document what he can do or she can do, and send that patient out with a referral where appropriate, and then mark the progress with a re-examination every 12 visits or every 30 days, whichever is less, so we can mark as that patient progresses through care the progress that's made. We, in our seminars that we teach annually, We go over quite extensively the weaknesses and flaws that we find in documentation, and we won't go over that here, but that's one of the things that is going to be talked about at the Personal Injury Summit. Unfortunately, most of the chiropractic colleges put out great doctors, but they don't typically teach what needs to be taught in the forensic area. And that's something that the chiropractic graduate needs to come out and get additional training on. And there's many, many sources for that. The Whiplash Group is a source for that, and this particular seminar is a great source. There are others as well. But we love chiropractors. I rather hang with chiropractors than I would typically with attorneys. Who wouldn't? But even though I like my fellow attorney friends as well. If any attorneys are listening to this, if you do personal injury work, if you do soft tissue or connective tissue cases, you need to understand the field that the chiropractor works in. need to understand the concepts and principles the chiropractor works in. If you don't, you can't adequately represent your client.
So Brian, another question I wanted to have you, and it's a topic that I love the fact that the personal injury summit brings together, and that is the patient, the person that we're trying to all of us serve, because ultimately that's who we take an oath towards, you know, is to serve that customer, that patient in front of us. From your perspective, what is the mindset of these patients coming in? What are some of the issues that as doctors we need to be aware of? Because maybe they tell you things that they may not tell us, you know, but what are some of the things that you would teach us? And I know you cover that in your speaking, and I'm so excited you're going to be one of the keynote speakers at the event, because you're such a wealth of information. I mean, 35 years of very successful practice, and not only that, but maintaining an integrity and a great relationship, not only with the client, but also the physicians that work with you. And I love that about you and the reputation that you have. So tell me a little bit about what is the mindset of the patient? What do we need to be aware of? What are the stressors that are driving them to ensure that when we take care of them, we're taking all of that into consideration, not only to deliver what you may need in order to be able to have a good case and an accurate case regarding the progress and the benefit of the services that we're providing, but also, what do we say that we need to do for the patients themselves?
Remember that you're treating the person. This individual has probably had enough on their plate in life with the normal stressors of life before having an automobile crash that may have destroyed their car, injured them so that they can't work. They may be generating thousands of dollars worth of medical care and chiropractic care. Not just with a chiropractor, but they may have already gone to the emergency room, and who knows how many thousands they may have already billed. And during this time period, you may have somebody who happens to be the sole provider for their family. Furthermore, they may have had other members of their family in that car also injured, and they're worried about them. They're sick to death over the injured child who may be a part of this as well. And so sometimes we find people, it seems like in today's world, that are living on the edge anyway on a good day, and you give them something like an automobile crash that turns their entire world upside down, and you're going to find psychosocial stressors, PTSD, you're going to find depression, you're going to find a whole number of things, and that person may suddenly not be the sweet, kind, nice individual that they once had been. They may be frustrated, they may be angry, and not only that, but the good neighbor that's promised that they would always be there for them suddenly is now their enemy, and is not stepping forward to pay the claim, and is challenging them on everything that they think occurred or happened in the automobile crash. And it's a very, very difficult, very, very stressful time. And sometimes, figuratively speaking, some client hand-holding needs to take place. We do an awful lot of that. At the end of the day, at the end of the process, you want your clients to do three things. And I'm going to paraphrase something that Dr. Jim Naccarato teaches. And by the way, if you don't know who Jim Naccarato is, you need to find out. He's an exceptional chiropractic advocate, somebody who's got a PhD in psychology as well. But his concept is that he wants clients to stay, pay, and refer others. You want them to be happy enough campers that they refer their family and friends to you, and that therefore build your practice. His concept about staying, we like to see personal injury patients eventually converted to wellness patients, although you need to make a good clear line of demarcation between what care is related to the automobile crash and what's related to simple wellness or maintenance. And we can talk about that some other time. But those kinds of things, when you do your job right, that patient is now going to become part of your extended chiropractic family, if you will, and they will come back to you. They'll refer others to you. And do you think I want to put this face on TV to advertise? Heavens no. I want to make sure that what I do, the job that I do with my clients, is just like Dr. Naccarato says. I want them to come back to me. I want to, as often happens now at this point in my career, I get somebody to come into me that'll say, you don't know me, but you represented my grandmother 20 years ago, and you did a good job for her, and she told me to come to see you. And that's the kind of referral that makes the job satisfaction level be extremely high. And when you get a client on those rare occasions that say, you changed my life, you helped my life, that's the kind of chiropractic physician we'd like to see. I got to tell the story of just one individual, and I'll mention his name because it's a good story. There's a Dr. Brian Rosquist down in Pleasant Grove. I had a client that he represented, or he treated. And this young man, when I first saw him, he was very, very heavy. He was pushing 400 pounds, probably over 300 anyway. And during the course of the treatment, Dr. Rosquist got on this young man and got him to do physical therapy very aggressively. During the course of the treatment, between the time I initially saw him and the time we eventually got the case resolved and he came into the office, we handed him a check, and I told him, "What? You're looking great. What's happened to you? You've lost so much weight." And he says, "I've lost 126 pounds. He said, "Thank you for sending me to Dr. Rosquist. It was a life-changing experience. He changed my life. He helped my injuries, yes, but more importantly, he made me see health as a valuable thing that I wanted to desire in my life and I wanted to have." And that's the kind of chiropractor we like to work with, somebody who's going to make a real difference in a person's life.
Well, Brian, I just want to say, you know, we're so excited to have you on the Personal Injury Summit again. I know that you're one of the favorite speakers every year because you bring so much value and so much content. And remember, for those of you that are listening, if you want to be at the top of your game when it comes to taking care of personal injury patients or any type of whiplash patients, this is the event you can't afford to miss. Like Brian has said, we don't get a lot of this information in the school. And as you know, the school has so much to teach you to pass the national boards. But this is day-to-day life. We know today that many patients are going to have car accidents. Many patients are going to have whiplash injuries. And we are the people that they should be coming to. And every so often, they're going to need an attorney. And you have individuals like Brian that are going to help them represent them the best way, and primarily working side by side with you to ensure that we actually do the best work that we can do for represent that patient, because that's what we do. We want to take care of that patient like if it was a family member. So, Brian, I just want to say thank you so much. I know you're going to be amazing at this event. And for those of you that are listening, I'm going to put the link right now. Please join us on March 15th through the 17th in Salt Lake City, Utah, where the Personal Injury Summit will be taking place next year, 2019. You don't want to miss this. This is the premier event in personal injury in the chiropractic profession. And as you know, every year they bring the biggest names out there to teach you and to make it simple for you to implement in your practice. So, Brian, God bless you. Thank you so much for being with us. And I look
forward to it. God bless you too. If I don't see you between now and the summit, Merry Christmas to you.
Merry Christmas to you. Take good care.
You bet. Bye-bye now.